Hopefully they board. Hopefully it's a transient class.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, can I have your attention, please? Can we have quiet on the set? It is my most humbled honor to welcome our guest, Ani Cyrus, here to give an absolutely fantastic talk. I had the pleasure of meeting Ani basically through social media and through some of my friends, Diana Kloss, Hack for America, and through the Worcester Tea Party itself. And this is some of the things that we do here. As you can see, we gather all these people together, we announce an event, so that we can educate the public on something as important as what Ani's gonna talk about. But before we get started, if I might have all of you, as Matt Ryan would say, upstanding,
yep.
Give the Pledge of Allegiance.
Sorry about that.
Ani, could you please lead us off? Okay.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Born and unborn.
Yes. So here we are. This absolutely fantastic event, all of these people coming together. This is a great collaboration. This is what the Worcester Tea Party is branching out and doing now. Through my radio show, we're working with Act for America, with Diana Kloss. We'll be working in the future with other various liberty groups in and around the state of Massachusetts to bring absolutely fantastic guests to our events here. As I said, I had the great pleasure of meeting this fantastic woman through social media. She was on my radio show Tuesday, it was. And we talked about an in-depth conversation. It was absolutely very enlightening. And this is what she's going to educate you people on this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure, it is my honor. I'm calling my good friend, Ani Cyrus. Ani, thank you.
Possible. If you have calls during me, please wave and I will try to raise my call. Thanks for being here. My full name is Inaz Ani Cyrus. I was born and raised in the Islamic Republic of Iran. Some of you might know it as Iran.
Yeah.
I was born in 1983. Yes, I am 33 years old. And that makes it after the Islamic Revolution in the country. Some of you might know about it. Some of you might even know about it before the revolution, but Iran was known as the America in the Middle East. Anyways, lucky me, I was born after the revolution when the country was completely Islamic. Meaning, the constitution, the civil code, and the penal code is all gathered from Sharia, combination, Quran, words of Allah, Sunnah, life of Muhammad, Hadith, the stories told by those who knew Muhammad. On top of that, I was also born into a religious family. My father was a sheikh, meaning he made Islamic ruling. My mother was a Quran teacher. And yes, he also taught me Quran. So I'm very, very, very educated when it comes to Quran. Everything was pretty normal, lovely, as a kid, until I was about 6 years old. Everything was normal, you know, little girl, running around, playing with my dolls, and, you know, maybe dancing, maybe singing, having friends. By the time I was in the middle of my sixth, I started hearing from my mother that things are gonna change gradually. You're gonna start learning different things and you're gonna start being prepped. Okay, what am I learning? She said, well, you're gonna start going to school, therefore you're gonna start wearing a hijab. Okay, you don't have to wear it on the streets, but you will have to wear it at a school. Now, bear in mind, all the schools from first grade all the way to university, classes are separated. Girls have their own school with female staff, and boys have their own school with male staff. But I still have to work a job. Okay, that was okay. So the first day of going to school, they put me in this, you know, uniform with a loose pants, down to my knee overcoat, and a white head cover down to my chest. And my father took me to school on the first day. Okay. On our way to school, I started seeing boys going to school just normal, wearing, you know, pants and t-shirt. So I asked my dad, "Hey dad, why am I wearing a hijab and being completely covered except my face and my hands, and boys are not?" I received a very, very logical answer, and that was a punch to my face. Fast forward, when I was 9 years old, one day at a school, I received a very fancy card. It was an invitation card to an event called Requirement Day. It was a ceremony. So I took that home, gave it to my parents, and my dad was absolutely excited. My mom was happy. And they explained to me that we're gonna have to make you a very special, specific type of hijab, which was pretty much a long burqa, color white. All you could see was my face out of it. And my mom practiced the prayer with me a couple of times and verses of Quran that I had to be, you know, very good at and memorize. Anyways, we prepped and the day is here. Let's go. We are ready. Everybody's excited. I walked into this place where it was filled with 9-year-old girls. And we all looked the same. Everybody was wearing the same hijab as I was, including the headband that was black with a giant red rose on it. Some of them I knew because they were my classmates, some of them I didn't. They sat us down, and a mom came in, went on the stage behind the microphone and started citing Quran and saying verses here and there, and then he went saying, "Congratulations, all of you girls here, starting right now, are considered an adult woman." I paused and went, "Okay, let me see what does that mean." He went on to say, "You're gonna obey Sharia, you're gonna follow Muhammad, you're gonna die or kill in the name of Allah. And if your male guardian, being your father's father, or your brother, decide it's time for you to get married, you will get married." I never tried to tell anyone how it felt, because I can't. There are so many emotions I can throw out that I felt at that moment. But the biggest thing was anger, because I ran from this girl with no responsibility. All I had to care for was to do my homework and have good grades, and play with my friends and catch sleep. And in a split second, they told me I have to become a responsible adult woman. And at any point, I could actually become a wife. After that, he asked us to all get up, repeat after him, and he started saying the Shahada. Shahada is what you say to finalize your conversion to Islam. The entire room repeating. And just for the record, I did not repeat after him, so technically I am not an ex-Muslim. It was over. They handed us these certificates that literally had my name, and it said that I am officially on the Islamic Republic of Iran, a woman. They sent us home. A few days later, I started seeing classmates disappearing. Later, I came to realize they were married off. Since I was an adult woman, I was responsible for my actions, so I had to face consequences myself. One of the consequences I had to face was one day, coming back from school with a friend of mine, being a teenager, being a girl, a bubbly girl like me, we decided to kind of start whispering the song that we liked. We got carried away, we got a little loud. Before we knew it, we got arrested. When I say arrested, yes, we were in handcuffs, put in police cars, taken into detention center. Another time, I was arrested because I attended a party where boys and girls were in the same room. That is adultery in Iran. For going to that party, not having a hijab when I was arrested and the party was raided, dancing and singing and being in the same room with guys, I earned myself 35 lashes. Another time, I had to get a cab to go home. Backseat was full, so I sat in the front seat. Passengers started getting off. I didn't move to the back. I stayed in the front seat. We got pulled over by morality police. Detention center again. In the morning, I went to court. The driver said, we are having a relation, so you would get off. I said, you didn't. The judge said, can you bring a witness to testify? I said, well, no, we were in the car alone. Okay. I earned myself 75 lashes. I managed to buy 50 of them, but I still had to face 25 of them. This goes on and on. By the time I reached my 14, I was arrested over 12 times, lashed over 100 times. I was raped repeatedly while being in detention center. Anyways, at age 14, my father had it. I was a bad girl. I brought way too much shame to the family. I was a criminal, 12 times of arrest. So one day he came to me and he said, we're going to a friend of his. It was an office. We walked in, there was a conference room. Two guys sitting by the conference table or whatever you call it. He sat down, had me sit next to him, and he looked at me and said, meet your future husband. The guy, the older guy was his brother, younger guy being 35, 6, 7. I honestly don't know the exact year, age. About 35 to 37 was the guy introduced to me as my future husband. He said, I'm going to be his wife. I wasn't 14 yet. Very close to 14. So I looked at him, I got choked up, I got scared, I got terrified. But the only thing I didn't feel was surprised. For some reason, it didn't shock me at all. So I didn't say anything at that point. When we left, when we got home, I started crying. Then I started, kind of sort of begging daddy figure. If I cry and if I beg, he's going to feel bad and he's going to let it go. Didn't work. Then I tried to fight him. Didn't work. So, as planned, this man married me in a sort of a, if you call it a chapel, city hall room. I don't know. You don't, thankfully, we don't have them here yet, so there's no neighborhood. And he took me home. Home was basement. He showed me the kitchen. He showed me the bedroom. And our marriage life started. I was his wife. Let me rephrase that. I was his child bride for a year and a couple of months. Every day, if he wasn't beating me, he was raping me. If he wasn't raping me, he was beating me. I went to my father and I said, for love of God, will you please get me a divorce? Because I can't take neither one of those in God. And again, please remember, we're talking about a 15-year-old teenager, not me standing there. My father said, I know you. You can't bite your tongue. You can't listen to orders. So, he has no choice but to leave. You want to stop? Obey him. Do what he wishes, and I promise you he won't be evil. And that's it. Okay, problem solved. Send me back home. A few months later, over the fact that my food was too salty and he thought I was taking revenge on him, so I purposely made it salty, he started beating me. He managed to dislocate my shoulder, leave a bruise on my face, and leave me with a bloody lip.
You're in front of the camera.
Oh. So I got up, put myself together, and went to a court. Walked into a courtroom, looked at the judge and said, Your Honor, you have got to stop this man from killing me. Save me, he will kill me. Give me a divorce. He looked me right in the eye with a calm face and said, Well, young lady, maybe you should start obeying your husband so he doesn't have to beat you. Now go home and make him happy. And that was the moment I realized this is it. I live in a country that nobody's going to protect. The law is against me. Government is against me. My father doesn't care. So I'm gonna end up dying here and nobody's gonna know. I had a grandmother who was decent, who was loving and was caring. So she stepped in, found a smuggler who was willing to take me out. So they grabbed me, they smuggled me out of country to Turkey, and I became a legal refugee in Turkey, went through proper channels, respectfully waited my term until I got acceptance to America, came to America in 2002. Again, waited, went through proper channels, did the forms, did the paperwork, and in 2010, I became a very proud American citizen. Right after that, I decided to come out and publicly tell my story. I don't tell my story because of people. Believe it or not, it doesn't get easier and it doesn't heal my wounds. I tell my story because there is a very specific reason for what happened to me. Let me review. At age 9, I was called a woman in my motherland. Reason. There's a guy named Muhammad. He's the prophet of a so-called religion called Islam. He consummated his marriage to Aisha when she was 9 years old. Based on that, I became a woman at age 9. I was sold off to marriage, and in return, my father received 50 American dollars and opium for his usage of a month. It's my fifth language. I'm not that good at it, but I'm pretty sure phobia is where you have the irrational fear. Under Islam, I was raped, beaten, sold to marriage as a property, put in prison, lashed, literally as a person, shattered into pieces, and my fear is irrational? I don't think so. They called me racist. I did ask them what race is Islam because I will stop talking about it if it is race. And the moment they call me anti-Islam speaker is when that was a fatwa, brand new fatwa issue. Let me break that down for you. Many patriots out there, many counter-jihad organizations are being called out by care. They're normally being called uneducated, hate speeches, bigoted, racist, Islamophobe. I am officially, if you look into, I did an actual search on their website, the only anti-Islam speaker was me. Reason is, what is anti-Islam? Someone who's anti-Islam is basically anti-Allah and Muhammad. Read the Quran. Punishment for someone who's against Allah and Muhammad is death. So that's how they release the information to all the moderate, loving American citizens that I should be taken out because I am speaking against Allah and Muhammad. Now that's the moderate category of, you know, suit-bearing American people, Muslims. Then I have a fatwa from Supreme Leader of Islamic Republic of Iran, leading a Shia country of Islam. I'm supposed to be taken back to stand trial. Crimes, propaganda against the regime, propaganda against the Supreme Leader, waging war against Allah, spying for America. These are my crimes, every single one of them, by the way. You look at Penal Code of Islamic Republic of Iran, every single one is punishable by death. Now why they want me to stand trial, I don't know. So that's the Shia side. And then I have a fatwa from Noel, Missouri. I don't know if you know, you better remove the pin to see that area on the map. A Sunni imam there issued a fatwa on me September 30th, 2017. You see, they all fight each other, and apparently every single one of them have a wrong version of Islam, but they have one in common correct version. Kill her. And unfortunately, all of you sitting in this room are under the same umbrella. They will find a reason to kill you. Again, not because they're radical, not because they're sickos, because Muhammad did it. Muhammad is a perfect example, so they have to do it.
Aren't they just fundamentalists, not radicals? They're fundamentalists, the ones who want us dead.
They believe
what the Quran says, so they're fundamentalists.
By definition,
fundamentalist is a dangerous word. It applies to too many other things.
Yeah. And now, let's talk about reformers. I have talked to many of them. What are we reforming? Are we literally taking the prophet out of the picture and putting a new one in there? Or are we just going to close our eyes and we're going to say, hey, I'm going to praise this prophet who had a six-year-old husband, a wife, who had 11 wives at a time, who killed everyone who did not follow him, and we're going to be fine with it? You might as well just start a brand new cult with a brand new prophet without a prophecy. That's easier. So, my 15 years of torture is done and over with. But there are so many who are still suffering. Women and children. Always remember, women and children under Islam are number one victims of Islam. Because they are treated as nothing, property. So, in order for you to be able to fight for your country, you might push them back, but unless you go to the root of the problem and find a solution and apply the solution, there is no saving your land. You have to, again, go beyond borders. Islam needs to be gone from everywhere. One, and I always say, yes, I'm a woman, a Persian woman, American citizen. You know, I'm a freedom fighter, I'm a human rights activist, but before all of that, I'm a human. If I'm willing to go to sleep knowing a 9-year-old, 10-year-old, 7-year-old is being married all tomorrow morning and I can get to sleep like a baby, there's a problem with human society now. It can't happen. Can't. So, as a human, it's all of our duties to get educated on the issue of Islam. And then from there, get other people educated on the issue of Islam. And from there, unite as human society and fight back. Every person, every single life matters. That's my belief. And knowing that in average, based on reports right here, every year there are 1,200 honor killings happening in America, and you're okay with that, is scary.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The fact that we hear at Sumner that the girl was killed in name of Allah, and a week later, some new fashion or new storm or new earthquake distracts us and that person is forgotten, it's bad. The fact that we're willing to go into our building and say hi to our nice, loving, caring, moderate Muslim neighbor without standing there and say, quick question. I get it, you're moderate and you love America, but here's my question. If there was a fatwa issued tomorrow by your local mosque imam to kill me, what would you do? There are two answers. Oh no, I don't do jihad. Okay, buddy, then you're not Muslim. Or, well, I would have no choice but to kill you. Well, I'm guessing everybody will have a different answer to that one. But there are just two scenarios into this problem. You're either a Muslim or you're not. Those who are not Muslims, fine. I have no problem with them. Those who are here as our enemy. And unless you know your enemy, you cannot fight your enemy. Fortunately and unfortunately, I know the enemy because they waste me as they destroy me. So it's my job to come out and try to tell all of you who the enemy is or what the enemy is. What you do with this information from here on out is completely up to you. Thank you.
They
told me if they showed up at your door, call us.
So you have to almost wait to get killed before anybody would intervene.
Pretty much, I have to wait until I'm killed until somebody will intervene.
The other thing, I just want to have one more question. As an American woman, I'm 60 now, and I feel like I'm very blessed to have freedom in this country. I cannot tell you some of my colleagues professionally, women on the left that think we're oppressed. What do you think of these foolish women that have no idea how less fortunate we are to run around with pussycat
vagina hats
against whatever whites they feel of being oppressed. And I'm not saying anything about, I know someone, I work in the field of mental health, I know women that are sexually abused, I get it. But we're talking about people that just feel, oh, we are being oppressed by this current president, not realizing how much the oppression is increasing under the other. What do you think of American women complaining? I'm not talking about people that fool me then, but just people that want to join this resist. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, let me quickly explain something before I get to that. Information.
Yeah.
Yes. I actually do fight for women who are,
yes,
you know, sexually,
yes,
assaulted,
yes,
and abused.
Yes.
But my point always is, in America, if you're raped or assaulted sexually, you walk into the police department, you make a report, and there is a possible, good possibility they will make an arrest, and that's where justice is served. In Islamic Republic of Iran, when I was raped, my grandmother looked at me and said, don't you dare tell anybody, your father's gonna kill you.
Right.
Or I had to bring four male witnesses to my rape, or I would be stoned to death because I just admitted to adultery. That's the difference.
Right.
So these women who are fighting for their rights, to me, I have talked to them. I'm like, tell me which right is it you're looking at? Because the right is there. Now, if you're not either capable or smart enough to use it in the right way, that's your personal problem, not a country problem.
Right.
Yes.
Yes.
Very good. Hey, Bonnie, you had a question.
I want to say that I feel really blessed to probably be in the best protected room in this whole city right now. Thank you, Tom. Thank you to everyone who protects you. As a mother, could be your mom. I mean, my heart just breaks. I could cry for you. I just cannot imagine the pain that people go through. So can you just, you know, in that sense, a little bit about your grandmother. She was really gutsy to get you out.
Yes. My grandmother was in her late 40s when the revolution happened. So she was raised knowing there's a better way of life. So she was too old to be brainwashed with the new system. So and also she was not. Publicly, a lot of people are Muslim, but in reality, at home, she was not a Muslim. And as she said always, her God told her to protect you. Those were her reasons.
I mean, I'm so thankful to her and so thankful for your story, and I just wish more people in this country would listen.
Yeah.
I've seen Gabriel, I mean, you know, the North Carolina Tea Party in conjunction with Worcester years ago did, we had 400 or 500 people show up. I mean, this is a follow-up, and we forget. We forget. Thank you.
So when you talk about your grandmother, people, I don't think people understand, but this was probably during a time during the Shah, when the Shah of Iran was in power. And if you know anything about your history, the Shah of Iran, Iran was very westernized. We also saw that in Afghanistan in the 60s and 70s. Very westernized, very up-and-coming part of the Middle East, that all of a sudden, this happened. That's a political thing that's beside point. But this is what happened to Ani. She grew up post Shah. Let's say Ani was a lot older. Most of us out here, like our age, she herself would know. Oh, I grew up under the Shah. I remember a very westernized Iran. She grew up post that, didn't you?
Yes.
So that's what happened. Ed, you had a question? Go ahead.
Well, now I probably have many, but I just wanted to be clear. Who was it in Massachusetts that declared you out of bounds? I wanted to.
CARE.
Council of America.
Okay, CARE. Yeah, I know about CARE. I didn't know.
Are they the place that has.
So, are they based? Is the local, the Massachusetts CARE, are they affiliated with the Boss Roxbury Mosque?
That is a question that I do not have an answer to.
Okay. I see flyers of the Roxbury Mosque. I live within 3 miles of that mosque, so I'm rather interested.
Well, there's a good chance, but I don't know for sure.
I've read the Quran twice, starting 10 years ago, because I wanted to know if we were justified fighting an eternal war in Afghanistan and Iraq. And I've read a lot of the deeds, and I've gone to several seminars like this. And I have Muslim neighbors and I have Muslim co-workers. And I try to engage them in their faith, because Christians will prophesize, especially Protestants, Catholics not so much, Jews not so much, but Christians usually will. And I try to engage them in their faith and ask them, you know, I have almost a photographic memory, and I go right to the Quran. I'm glad it took them till 9 to consummate with 8 or 6. So, you know, 3 years is 3 years. But so in engaging my neighbors, no one will engage. No one will talk about their faith. They say they're Muslim. And what I get from my Norwegian wife is everyone just wants to feed their kids. Everyone's good people. And we had 2 million Muslims on 9/11. Now we have 7 million Muslims in this country. So we 5 million more, not all bad, right? So what is your opinion on engagement, Muslims and their faith, and are there moderate? The point is, I've read the Bible about 12, 13 times, the Old Testament a couple times, being Christian. I've read the Quran twice. It has a cadence and a beat to it. When I'd read it, I would get jacked. I was reading it in English. I couldn't imagine, I listened to it in Arabic. It jacks you up. In this book, it's an evil book, and I don't understand the difference between Iblis, the devil, and Allah. They seem like one and the same. And Iblis is rarely mentioned, and Allah sounds like the devil. So just in talking, I don't believe that there are moderates, except they don't know their faith at all. But they won't engage. You cannot engage a Muslim about their faith.
I actually read the Quran over 40 times.
38 times more than they could.
And trust me, not a single time was with us. Reason you can't engage them. A split second, if a Muslim doubts Allah, he will land in hell. And the hot oil will be poured all over his skin, and he will regrow, and every day repeat all the process. That's why they won't talk to you. That's too scary to doubt.
And that's Iblis, in hell, with Iblis.
Yes. And I'm not even trying to be funny here, but when you say there's no difference between Eblis and Allah.
I can't see a difference.
Here's the difference.
One's powerful.
No, no. Eblis will tell you that I'm Eblis and I'm here to make you commit sin. Allah will tell you I'm the greatest of creator and I'm taking you to heaven. At least Eblis is honest. Allah is. That's the only difference between them, as far as I'm.
But
there are no Muslims. There are self-proclaimed Muslims,
but the Muslim,
hoping that they can cherry-pick Quran. Right. Where in Quran itself says, if you cherry-pick my words, you will go to hell. Yes. You won't be considered as Muslim. So there is one way to be a Muslim, and that is to follow Muhammad. Again, you have got to follow Muhammad. If you're not doing it, you're not a Muslim.
But the Muslim heaven is rivers flowing beneath the shaded trees, wine, milk, honey, and non-alcoholic water, and a throne of gold, and many virgins with big brown eyes.
72 virgins and young boys serving them.
Yes, and boys are mentioned. But the point is, the difference with the Christian God is we will be in communion with Christ.
Yeah, but you see,
so
right there,
their
right
heaven
there
is even heaven.
Right there is a problem. Don't ever compare Islam with any religion, because Islam is not a religion.
No, it's a political system.
Apples and oranges. You can't compare it with it.
What do you call it?
What would you call it? I would call it an ideology.
Well, one of the things that you said when I interviewed on the show is you likened it to a cult. And one of the things when I had talked about was, like Scientology, Islam is just made up by some guy.
Mm-hmm.
Just Muhammad. He just made this
thing up. Well, no, Islam isn't made up by Muhammad. Allah was made up by Muhammad.
Right.
This made up God was made up by Muhammad. Because, again, you study Quran, you study Hadith, you put two and two together, trust me, it doesn't take that much time. Every single word, everything in Quran, everything in Hadith, somehow is extremely convenient for Muhammad. It's all about Muhammad.
Yes. So, what is your take on Muslims in Iran that are being held and whatever they're getting, they're being held in Iran? What are your thoughts on that?
I'm not sure what you mean by being held anymore.
What do you mean?
It's not just Baha'is, any other religion. If you're not a Muslim, one way or another, you either end up in prison or you will leave as a somehow third-class citizen in Iran, where they will basically force you out of country. You know? Actually, a huge number of Baha'is are not in Iran anymore. They are being smuggled out of country, become refugees and go to other countries. But it's not just Baha'is. If you're a Sunni Muslim in Iran, you will be executed. However, they're not going to come and say this person was executed for their faith or belief. They say he was a drug dealer and she was a, you know, thief, and they will basically make up crimes. But we have worked cases where the specific reason was their, you know, belief. We have freed over three Christian women from prison, took them out. By Turkey, we got out of the country to a safe place. But it was all the faith. So it's not just for life. Any other religion, you will somehow find your way to the present. Yes, sir.
I want to get your opinion of something now that you have the fortune to be here. You and many other 9-year-old girls can be sold into sex slavery, become wives, and we all know it really isn't a wife, it's a sex slave. You can be raped and mistreated and beaten. How do you feel about political leaders like Elizabeth Warren, Hillary Clinton, Nancy Pelosi, who stand up and say, we need to support, you know, and welcome Islamic people, and pretend to love women and want to protect girls, and I mean girls, and boys, because you're so right. I'm glad you mentioned that, because that's something that, you know, you're not supposed to be homosexual over there, but they can all have their boy slaves, sex slaves. How do you feel about that?
Actually, I'm glad you mentioned that, because I do have spiders. I do have some books and DVDs, but specifically about what you said, have you read this book, United in Hate? What is it? United in Hate.
Bye.
If you haven't, I strongly suggest you pick one up. Dr. Jamie Glazer.
Yes.
I was pissed off and frustrated about the situation, but I didn't know the answer until I read this book. Here's the reason. Mentality, or I call it ill mentality of the left. Whatever it takes, they just want to burn down America as we know.
Yep.
Whatever it takes. Yep. Now there's an unholy alliance between the left and Islam. Reason, Islam goes against every single American value.
Yep. That's right.
Yeah.
So what do we do?
We bring them in.
But then they don't think any further than, okay, they come in, they burn America down, and they build the Sharia America. The what? Hillary, you really think you're going to get away with it? Then they're going to tell you it's okay, you don't earn any job, I'm not going to rape you. They just don't think that far. The ultimate goal for them is take America down, and they have this delusional utopia that they're going to build. That's the only reason they do it. Every single one of them, from Hillary Clinton being powerful all the way to Linda Sarsour,
yeah,
and everyone between, and the 5 million women washing the street behind them. They all have the same mentality. They just hate America so badly, they're willing to bring anything in that's going to take America down.
And you know, the amazing thing is, which I don't understand about so many of these progressive leaders and people that have the progressive mindset, that if, God forbid that it happens, that the United States becomes Sharia, the first ones are going to get killed are all the loudmouth women, and all these women like we're talking about, and all the gays.
Yeah.
Okay? And it just blows my mind that these people stand up and defend this. It's not a religion. It's really a cult, right? Because it's a moon god.
Well, it's what we call the useful idiot axiom.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
May I respectfully say?
Let's get this question.
Well, I just have a comment and a question. Well, the comment is, I knew a minister from Ghana who was asked when he was in Ghana, why are you supporting the Christians when you should know that the Muslims are going to win in the long run, because the religion that kills is probably going to win against the religion that turns the other cheek. And you're giving warning, and it's nice, but do you have any suggestions what we do?
Yes. I always say start by getting educated. Because if you get educated enough in concept of Islam and Sharia, you'll start to realize, as much as they seem to be the same thing, they're not. Islam and Sharia are two different departments. And the Sharia department can easily, and I mean easily, be banned in America based on our Constitution. So if enough people are educated, enough people can make it happen to them, ban Sharia. You ban Sharia, Islam will fall apart. That's the only solution. Only solution. There's no other way. Yes.
Then talk to Michael. He's the expert. I respectfully dissent. The first people that are going to be killed are repressing Christians. All the left liberals who are supposedly espouse liberal values that are opposed to Sharia are not that liberal to begin with. They'll find a way to make an accommodation. Repressing Christians, they will not. So they will go first, and then they will have good attendance.
But basically, everybody's going to go, one way or another. Christian, Jew, atheist, gay, straight, doesn't matter. They're going to clean house, unless somebody's willing to go and convert. Yes.
You know, I've read a lot of books. I've read about Irene, I've read From Desires, which is one by Geraldine Wilson, which I highly recommend. But anyway, the Awanas here in Michigan, I have heard, not just there, but there are parts of our country that some people practice Sharia.
I think I'm just doing my share of the human society I talked about. If I isolate myself, okay, that's Sharia area, I'm going to stay away. Who's going to go there to tell all the Muslim women that, hey, I'm here and there's hope. If you want to reach out, you can be saved. But yes, there are way more than Dearborn, Michigan areas that are literally practicing Sharia. To make it clear, if there is a mosque, there is Sharia being practiced because mosque is a Sharia court. There are enough Muslims practicing Sharia that they need their own justice system, so a mosque is built up.
I want to get Mike in here. Go ahead. Mike, go ahead.
I just wanted to understand what you have in mind when you say ban Sharia. For example, if two Muslims voluntarily contract with each other, and they write in the contract that if there's a dispute, it would be adjudicated according to Sharia, is that something you would ban?
I am so sorry, I did not catch that. If they're doing a contract, what do you mean by it?
Personal.
They're doing business with each other.
They do it voluntarily.
And they write in the contract if they have a dispute, it goes to arbitration according to a Sharia court. Is that something we
Yes, that needs to be banned.
Exactly.
Even though it's voluntary between two individuals.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, but you need to understand that entering
a... If you let me, Chris, please. If you live in this country, there are two things that you cannot override. Number one is the law of the country.
Yeah.
You are living in this country, you have to follow the law. Now with Sharia is always superior. Doesn't matter where you are, Sharia will override. Volunteer or not, you can't do it. You have got to respect the land. Because that's where it starts. You know,
what law would not be respected in that situation?
Let me tell you another volunteer contract that many Muslims are writing. Daddy and husband go to Sharia court in a mosque and get married to a 7-year-old. Should we let that happen because it's a volunteer contract?
Well, it's not voluntarily on the part of the 7-year-old.
Sharia says a virgin girl who has not reached the age of puberty being silent means she's agreeing to it. There you go. No, they have way too many loopholes for us to give them any opening. Everything about it needs, if there is a Muslim who like to go to Sharia court and get judgment, I strongly suggest get a one-way ticket to Islamic countries. Mm-hmm. More than welcome to do it there. Mm-hmm. We're not saying we're going to kill them, mm-hmm. but they can't do it here. Yes.
From London in West Boylston, about a year ago, there was a speaker that came to the public library, and it was called Islam 101. So I went, and she said some very interesting things, like Islam is the religion of the world. I had asked her a question about Wikipedia, which is they have permission to lie in order to perform their agenda. And she said that was made up, that was propaganda.
If you ever meet her again, ask her to go and read the 3rd chapter of Quran. Because on chapter 3, Allah says, and we gave you Muhammad and the book with some verses clearly meaning and some unclear for you to translate based on circumstances. That's the key right there. Word of Allah, not hadith, not sunnah, not some imam, not some ex-Muslim who's angry. Word of Allah himself. Mm-hmm. Now, what she was doing with you was actually taking
Yes,
right.
Yes.
She was in.
She wanted to bring that up.
The same woman I asked about female genital mutilation, and she said, no, that doesn't happen. That takes place in some African countries.
Oh, really?
That was her answer.
The fact that we just had a clinic shut down, I believe in Minnesota, performing female genital mutilation was just a delusion.
Right.
The thing that scared me is that half the people there don't need treatment.
Yes, more than half.
I'm guessing if I was about to take a very, very wild guess, I would say the organizer of that event was some leftist group.
Probably it was the library.
Because
she was at the mosque in Worcester.
But that's the thing. I hate to say it, but I would say they're way ahead of us. Yeah. Way ahead of us. Reason. I have been shut down. They managed to get some of my events canceled, so I can't go and speak out. Now, we don't have many, we do have a lot of people who are out there speaking against Islam, but we don't have many ex-Muslim female from Islamic countries like myself speaking out. Reason, I have spoken to many of my fellow Iranian women, asked them to join me. The first thing I hear is, why? So I can look over my shoulder for the rest of my life like you? So people of America can call me hateful, they can tell me that I'm Islamophobe and a bigot, and when I reach out for help, everybody's gonna turn their back on me. That's the thing. One, because the goal of the left is common, because there's one goal, they are extremely united.
Yeah.
So there are so many so-called Muslims out there telling how peaceful their religion is. How amazingly their prophet was a woman rights activist somehow magically in a 6-year-old boy.